We are talking about web application design to be specific. So in computing, the web application or a web app, it is a client-server software application in which the client or the user interface runs in a web browser. So common web application, they include the web mail, online retail sales, the online auctions, the wikis, the instant messaging services, and many other functions. So we'll see about the general design considerations, the specific design issues, the design considerations for layers, the testing and testability considerations, the technology consideration in web app, deployment considerations, and relevant design patterns, and certain other resources. So in this discussion, you'll be able to learn the general design considerations and key attributes for a web application. So this will include the guidelines for a layered structure, the guidelines for performance, the security, the deployment, and the key patterns and technology considerations. So a web application is just like any application. Now that can be accessed by the users through a web browser, or a specialized user agent. And the browser creates HTTP request for specific URLs that map to the resources on a web server. So the server renders and returns the HTML page to the client, which the browser can display now on the browser. And the core of the web application is its server-side logic. And this application can contain several distinct layers. And the typical example we have is three-layer architecture, which has a presentation layer, the business layer, and the data layer. Presentation, business, and data layer. And we'll see the figure. This illustrate the typical web application architecture with certain common components, which are grouped by different area of concern. So here we are talking about the web application. So you have a client, a browser, which is acting as the client side or the interface. And the web browser, it has, you know, as we just talked about, three layer. So it may have a presentation layer, the business layer, and the data layer. And in between, we have some umbrella design issues also, like the security, the operational management, and communication. In the presentation layer, the user interface component and process components are there. In the business layer, the application facade, we have business workflow, business components, and business entities. And in the data layer, as it is interacting with the data sources and the services, so we have data access components, the data helpers or utilities, and the service agents. And the typical structure of web application, the presentation layer usually includes the user interface and the presentation logic components. The business layer, it usually includes the business logic, the business workflow, and the business entity components. And optionally a facade. And the data layer usually includes the data access and service agents and components. So as we have just seen in the diagram also. There are general considerations, a design consideration when you want to design a web application. The goal of the software architecture is to minimize the complexity by just separating the task into different areas of concern while designing because you need to have a secure, high-performance web application. So we need to follow certain guidelines to ensure that our application meets the requirements, and it also performs efficiently in scenarios which are very common to the web applications. So we need to partition the application logically. That is, we use layering to partition the application logically into presentation, business, and data access layer. That is NDR architecture. This helps us to create maintainable code and allows us to monitor and optimize the performance of each layer separately and making a distinction between these layers. So a clear logical separation also would offer more choices for scaling your application also. And we need to use abstraction to implement loose coupling between layers. So this can be done by defining interface components like just I said facade with well-known inputs and outputs that translate your request into a format understood by the component within the layer. So in addition, you can also use the interface types or abstract-based classes to define a shared abstraction that interface components that must implement them. And need to understand how components will communicate with each other. Means this would again require an understanding of the deployment scenarios your application must support. So we must determine if the communication across physical boundaries or process boundaries should be supported, or if all components will run within the same process. Then we need to consider the caching to minimize the server round trips. We don't want to go to the server again and again. So when designing a web application, we need to consider or consider the techniques using, say, cache or output buffering to reduce the round trips between the browser and the web server and between the web server and downstream servers. So a well-designed caching strategy is probably the most important performance-related design consideration, like ASP.NET. In ASP.NET, the caching features, it include output caching, partial page caching, and cache API. So the design of your application need these features to be encompassed. And then to consider the logging and instrumentation, that is, you should audit and log activities across the layers and tiers of your application. So these logs can be used to detect the suspicious activity, which frequently provides early indication of the attack on the system. And just bear in mind that it can be difficult to log problems that will occur with script code running in the browser. And authentication, consider authenticating user across trusted boundaries. So you should design your application to authenticate users whenever they cross a trust boundary, for example, when accessing a remote business layer from the presentation layer. Do not pass your sensitive data into plain text across the network. So whenever you must or you are passing sensitive data like password or authentication cookie across the network, always consider encrypting and signing the data as using the SSL encryption, secure socket layer encryption. And design your web application to run using a least privilege account. Means if an attacker manages to take control of your process, in any case, the process identity should have restricted access to the file system and other system resources in order to limit the possible damage. And what are the specific design issues? You must consider several common issues as you develop any of your design. So these issues are categorized into the specific areas of the design. You can see the sections coming up, which provide guidelines to help avoid common issues in each area, like the application request processing, the authentication, the authorization, the caching, the exception management, the logging and instrumentation, the navigation, the page layout, the page rendering, the session management, the validation. So in this application request processing, at a higher level, a web application can perform request processing in two ways. With the post-back approach, the browser primarily it will communicate with the server using some web forms post-backs. And there is an alternative approach, which is the RESTful services calls between the browser and the services. So these two approaches each have their own advantages and disadvantages, and your choice may impact how you address the design issues. So when choosing a request processing strategy, you should consider how much control you require over a user interface in your application, and your development and testing approach, and your performance and scaling requirements. So the post-back approach typically allows form-based development experience, and it uses the rich server-side controls that would render the corresponding HTML associated view state and the interaction logic to the browser. So just consider the approach if you are developing a form-based web application and you require a RAD, rapid application development experience. The RESTful approach typically allows fine-grained control over the user interface of the application. It also provides more flexibility in terms of navigability, testability, and separation of concerns. Just consider using this approach if your application requires flexible navigation, fine control over its user interface, and may use alternate user interface also, the rendering technologies related to it, or if you are using a test-driven development approach. So regardless of the request process or processing strategy you may choose, you should ensure separation of the concern by implementing the request processing logic, the application logic separately from the user interface. This is what we are calling as NTL. So several patterns help achieve this. In general, the model view presenter, MVP, MVC, etc. These are similar patterns that can be used in web forms post-back approach to help provide a clean separation of the concerns. We also have this MVC, as I just indicated, model view controller pattern, which is typically used in a RESTful request processing approach. And we need to follow certain guidelines when designing a request processing strategy. Just consider centralizing the common pre-processing and post-processing steps of web page request to promote the logic reuse across pages. So, for example, consider creating an HTTP module or a base class derived from the ASP.NET page class, to contain your common pre-processing and post-processing logic, and choose an appropriate approach or pattern for your user interface processing, and consider dividing your user interface processing into three distinct roles, that is model and view and your controller or your presenter. Okay, by using say MVC, MVP and similar related patterns, and just avoid mixing processing and rendering logic in your components. So if you are designing views for handling large amount of data, consider giving the view access to the model by using the supervising presenter or supervising control pattern, which is the form of your MVP pattern. If your application does not have a dependency on view state and you have a limited number of control events, consider using the MVC pattern, and just consider using the intercepting filter pattern to implement the processing step as pluggable filters whenever appropriate. So ensure that you protect all sensitive data sent over the network, especially over the internet, as we said that encryption etc. has to be done. So use secure channel protocols such as SSL, secure socket layer, and consider encrypting and digitally signing all highly sensitive data sent over both internet and internal and external networks. So in these terms, we'll talk about the authentication. What do we mean by authentication? So designing an effective authentication strategy is important for the security and reliability of your application. Improper or weak authentication can leave your application always vulnerable to spoofing attacks, dictionary attacks, session hijacking, and other types of attacks. Just consider certain guidelines when designing an authentication strategy. First, identify the trust boundaries within the web application layers. This will help you to determine where to authenticate the users. Enforce the secure account management practices like the account lockouts and password expirations and strong password policies that would specify the minimum password length and the complexity. Use a platform-supported authentication mechanism like the Windows authentication when possible. So when you decide to use forms authentication, take advantage of the building support, say in ASP.NET instead of designing a custom authentication mechanism. Consider using a federated service or say a single sign-on SSO if you want to allow user to log on to several sites with a single site of credentials. Like you do in Google, you enter into Google and now you have access to YouTube, Google Plus, etc. So when you must store password in a database, do not store them in plain text. Instead, store a hash, that is a salted hash of the password. Then comes the authorization. Authorization determines the task that the authenticated identity can perform, and it identifies the resources that can be accessed. So designing an effective authorization strategy is always important for the security and reliability of your application. And if you have improper or weak authorization, it will lead to information disclosure, data tampering, and the elevation of privileges. And defense in depth is the key security principle to apply your application's authorization policy or strategy. So again, certain guidelines for authorization strategy. Authorize users as they cross all trust boundaries. Use the URL authorization for page and directory access control, and access the downstream resources using a trusted identity, which is based on some trusted subsystem model we'll see later in the physical tiers and deployment. And consider the granularity of your authentication settings and building your authorization, which too much granularity means compartmentalization will increase your management overhead. But using the less granularity may reduce the flexibility also. Use the impersonation and delegation to take advantage of user-specific auditing and granular access controls of the platform, but consider the effect on performance and scalability. Then comes the caching. This caching improves the performance and responsiveness of your application. But incorrect caching choices and poor this caching design can degrade the performance and responsiveness also. So you should choose this caching to optimize the reference data lookups, avoid network round trips, and avoid unnecessary and duplicate processing. To implement the caching, you must first decide when to load data into the cache, and try to load cache data asynchronously or by using a batch process to avoid client delays. So we need to consider certain guidelines again for designing the caching. What it means is that cache data in a ready to use format when possible, and avoid caching volatile data that changes regularly. This is very important. Just avoid caching sensitive information unless it is in some of the encrypted form. Use the output caching to cache pages that are relatively static, that are not changing. And this dramatically improves the performance, which still, while still it's supporting variation based on submitted values. So if only parts of the page are relatively static, just consider using partial page caching with user controls. And these pool shared resources that are quite expensive, such as network connection, instead of caching them. Then comes the exception management. So when it comes to the exception management, designing an effective exception management strategy is important for the security and reliability of your application always. So the correct exception handling in your web pages, it will prevent sensitive exception details from being revealed to the user. It will also improve the application robustness, and it will help us to avoid leaving your application in a certain inconsistent state if a certain error should occur. So we need to consider certain guidelines in this case also for exception management strategy. Provide user-friendly error messages to notify user of errors in the application, but make sure that you avoid exposing sensitive data in error pages or error messages or log files or audit files. Just ensure that you catch mishandled exceptions and clean up resources and state when an exception occurs. So design a global exception handler that displays a global error page or an error message for all unhandled exceptions, and avoid the use of custom exceptions when not necessary. And do not catch exceptions unless you must handle them, for example, to remove sensitive information or add additional information to the exception like this. And do not use exceptions to control application logic flow. Then comes the logging and instrumentation. So designing an effective logging and instrumentation strategy is very important for the security and reliability of your application. You should audit and log activity across the tiers of your application. So these logs can be used to detect the suspicious activity, which frequently provides early indications of an attack of the system. And this can help to address the repudiation threats where users deny their actions. So log and audit files may be required in legal proceedings to provide the wrongdoings of certain individuals. And auditing is generally considered to be the most authoritative if the audit is generated at the precise time of resource access and by the routine that accesses the resource. So consider again certain guidelines when you are designing a logging and instrumentation strategy. Consider auditing in all layers of the application for user management events, system critical events, business critical operations, and unusual activities. So just create secure log file management policies, like the restricting access to log files, allowing only write access to the users, and ensure that your logging and instrumentation mechanisms are configurable during deployment and when in production. And do not store sensitive information anytime in your log or the audit files. Then comes the navigation, an important design aspect, navigation in your web app. So design your navigation strategy in a way that separates it from processing logic. Separation from processing logic is important. So your strategy should allow users to navigate easily through your screens or pages. And designing a consistent navigation structure for your application will help in minimize your confusion, as well as it will reduce the apparent complexity of the application. And consider the guidelines when designing your navigation strategy also. So if you are using the web forms postback approach, consider using design patterns like we have seen in the MVP to decouple the user interface processing from the output rendering, and avoid mixing this navigation logic with your user interface component by handling navigation in the presenter. So if you are using the RESTful approach, consider using MVC pattern to decouple application logic data and navigation into separate components. Typical MVC model view controller application implementation, it provides flexible navigation support by directing requests to a controller component that then coordinates the application's user interface and data. And consider encapsulating navigation in a master page so that it is consistent throughout the application. But however, avoid hard coding navigation path anytime in your application, and ensure that users can only navigate to views for which they are authorized. Consider using a site map to help users find pages on the site and to allow search engine to crawl to that site if appropriate. And consider using visual elements like the embedded links, navigation menus, and breadcrumb navigation in the user interface to help users understand where they are, what is available on the site, and how they are going to navigate to the site quickly. And consider using wizards to implement navigation between forms in a predictable way. And in terms of the page or web page layout, design your application so that the page layout can be separated from user-specific, this specific user interface component and the user interface processing. This should be different. So when choosing a layout strategy, consider whether designers or developers will be building the layout. And if designer will be building the layout, choose a layout approach that does not require coding or the use of development-focused tools. And the guidelines for designing your layout strategy, what it could be, use this CSS, cascading style sheet, for layout whenever possible, rather than any tab-based layout. However, using this tab-based layout when you must support a grid layout or where the data is represented as a table, and just bear in mind that this table-based layout can be slow to render and there must be issues with the complex layout. Use a common layout for pages wherever possible to maximize the accessibility and ease of use. Avoid designing and developing large pages that would accomplish multiple tasks, particularly when only a specific task is usually executed with each request. And minimize the page size where possible to maximize the performance and reduce the bandwidth requirements whenever necessary. And just using, to master pages in certain server-side applications to provide common appearance and behavior for all the pages and to allow updates to the site with minimum effort. So consider extracting common sections of pages into separate user controls to reduce the overall complexity and allow reuse of these controls. Consider using certain ASP.NET AJAX server controls and the ASP.NET AJAX client-side library to make client script more easily portable between different browsers. And also avoid mixing client-side script with the HTML code. Doing so makes the page more complex and harder to maintain. So place client-side script in separate script files so they can be cached by the browser. And when migrating an existing web application, consider, say, using Silverline controls in ASP.NET pages to provide a rich user experience and minimize application re-engineering. Then the next aspect is page rendering. So when designing for a page rendering, you must ensure that you render the pages efficiently and maximize the interface usability. So consider the guidelines now for page rendering strategy. Consider using client-side script or say ASP.NET AJAX for an improved user experience and better responsiveness by reducing the number of post backs required. And using custom client-side script that can make application harder to test because script support varies between different browsers and versions. Instead, consider using this again same stuff which support most common browsers. And remember that the use of client-side code of any type, including the script emitted by the built-in ASP.NET control, that can affect the accessibility always. Ensure that you provide applicability or appropriate accessibility support for specialist user agent and disabled users. And consider the data binding options. For instance, you can bind collections, data reader objects, data set these tables and customer objects to many ASP.NET controls. Use the data paging techniques to minimize the scalability issues associated with large amount of data and to improve performance and response times. And consider designing to support localization in user interface components and abstract the user process components from data rendering and acquisition functions. So this was about the web app design. We'll be taking one more aspect of this in the later discussion. Thank you so much.